Starline TV, power to transform lives.
Welcome to another Wednesday of Family Life with Mama Rita. 2 weeks ago, we had Reverend David Alex Saki and Mama Gigoria. Oh, their story was so challenging. How they met, how finally Reverend David became a pastor in the same place he went for the first time when he was invited to church. Because without church, Mama Gigoria wasn't going to give him an answer. You see, sometimes God works in ways you can never understand. And I have come to realize that everybody's story is different. Don't listen to somebody else's story and think that yours will follow the same way. I always say it, that Lady Deacon Amma Gray was given a prophecy in ICGC that she was going to be married to a pastor. Unfortunately for her, when Reverend Agre came, Reverend Agre was nowhere near being a pastor. He wasn't even born again. But today, Reverend Agre is a reverend minister. So you were told you were going to get married to a pastor. You need another eye, an eye into the future, to see that the guy who is coming today, who is not a pastor today, could be a pastor tomorrow. If you are waiting for an already cooked pastor, you might not be married. So please, let's watch out. I think that I'll be bringing a lot of such stories. We'll be bringing couples in to tell us how they met and how they knew that this was Mrs. Wright and this was Mr. Wright. And before we close today, I will let you know what we'll be doing next week. Very, very interesting. Something that every couple must know, every husband must know, every wife must know, every to-be husband must know, and every to-be wife must know. But today, what we are going to do is that we are going to go straight into Ask Mama Rita, because we have a lot and a lot of backlog of questions. With me today, they are not a couple, but they are faces you have seen so many times on our screens. With me is Minister Fabio Wilson. But today what I did was I put Minister Fabio Wilson's wife away and I brought in another wife. Another face you have seen so well is Lady Deacon Rosemond Yorson. And what I did was that today I also put Reverend Patrick Yorson away. So we have Mama Rosemond and Minister Fabio Wilson, both of them coming from our teens ministry. Mama Rosemond is the head of our teen service, and then Minister Fabio Wilson is a parent of our teen service. And what's the last academic year? Now, our year is going to be changed again, I don't know. But this year, academic year started in January. Oh my God, they did so well in preparing the students for school. Their groceries, their trunks, their chobosses. I mean, this can only be Royal House Chapel. Thank you so much for what you did. You know, the number of children you bought, their provisions, their groceries, their milo, their milk, their sardines, their shito, the agari for school. God bless you so much. But is it 2 weeks ago or just a week ago, you had a program for the teens. I want us to talk about the program and how it went. Mama Rosemont, you first.
All right, so 2 weeks ago, we had this program called Emerge. Emerge is helping the children as to how to identify the various careers they want to be in. Mm. So we theme it building careers.
Building careers.
So what we did was brought in people who are professionals in some of the various careers that we have in the country to come and talk to them. Mm. Talk to them as in what you need to do. Mm. If this is actually what you want to be a doctor, what do you have to do in this state in which you are, JHS 1, JHS 2? You are aspiring to be a doctor. What do you need to do? Mm. What subjects do you need to take?
Okay.
What is the things you need to focus on in order for you to achieve the dream of becoming a doctor? Mm. So we brought in a doctor. We brought in an IT specialist.
Wow.
We brought in a banker.
Wow.
And then we brought one person who gave a general overview of all the various careers. Mm. And then we also brought in somebody from education, Ministry of Education, to talk to them about what you need to look at before you choose a school.
That's very
good. So we brought in that person to come and speak to them, to give them pointers as to what to look out for. Mm. And mommy, it was very successful. That day it rained. It rained that day, so we were a little scared that, but we had over 100 children coming
in.
Yeah. We had over 100 children coming in to listen and learn. And we had workshops, so we broke them into various professions, and the professionals spoke to them, they asked their questions, and we had very good feedback.
Minister Fabi, were you there?
Yes. So for me, one of the things that, like she mentioned, when someone came to speak to them about what subjects you should be looking at in moving on from GHS and to SHS, and so not also focusing on the names of the school, because some of them will follow friends in choosing schools because I want to go to the same school with this friend.
Okay.
What are some of the things you need to do? And that the resource person spoke about doing a little research. Don't just, you know, follow friends. And also you should look at what you intend to do in the future, because some of the schools are, you know, very good in particular areas. And so that gave a lot more, threw a lot more light on school choices, especially from GHS to SHS. And then overall, the program, I think the resource person and mommy, all the resource person were in-house. Yes, in-house. And they spoke about the medical and then the IT. And then
You didn't get a lawyer. I haven't had a lawyer.
So what we plan doing is we are going to do every year, so that we'll have a lot of time for question and answers. Okay. If we bring a lot, sometimes it limits the impact. So we will do some this year. Next year, we are going to look at the other professions that we couldn't bring on board this year. And when they were done, they also show the relationship between the various fields.
Okay.
So IT, you know, IT supports banking, IT supports medical, and those who want to go into IT. And it was so, even for us, the parents, I learned a lot from the professionals who came. So we were blessed.
I think it's an eye-opener to me myself, and that we need maybe a professional person, an educationist.
Yes.
Has the BCE been written already?
No, just about started.
17, they haven't started.
I think 17th October is when they start.
But I'm sure by now they've chosen their schools.
No.
They haven't. So maybe I think it's something I need to do quickly.
Yeah.
Okay. That we invite somebody from the education field to come and talk to us. Because a lot of the children, all they know is science.
Yeah.
What do you want to do? Science. What do you want to do? Science. They go into the schools and they realize that, I can't do science. You know, so what should they do? How should the parents prepare their children?
Yeah.
You know, what kind of schools we must look at? the kind of subjects, the kind of courses, the kind of combination. Somebody chooses first choice, Achimota. Second choice, Infansipen. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Third choice,
St. Augustine's. Yeah. Or first choice, Wesley Girls. Second choice, Holy Child. Mm-hmm. You know, these are things that are things that we need to learn. Very. So, co-host,
yes,
over to you.
Sure.
I think it's one of the topics we would have to do.
Yeah, I think we also, one thing I'm also looking at doing, the SHS, those writing WASI, they are writing now.
Okay.
By the end of the month, they are done.
Okay.
When they come home, they've started doing their university, filling their forms.
Okay.
But once the results come, a window is open for you to do changes based on your results.
Yeah.
We need to educate them as well.
Good.
As to, based on your result, what are the subjects, courses you can take?
Right.
So that makes it easier. Because last year I had challenges in that area too. Mm. And then I had Professor Steiner coming to me that we need to talk to them. Came to her begging and you just can't because of your grades, but they don't understand it. So we need to educate the SHS as well, moving to the university.
So I think we need to do that.
As well.
Now I'm getting confused. I have a topic for next week, but I'm really, really, as we are talking now, getting very confused. If I should do this before I go on to do the topic I want to do next
week. So we investigate on the timelines, the deadlines, if
it's not too late, we can go to it. It's something I really, really want to do. Here we have lots of questions.
Mommy, lots of it.
I tried to do a lot 2 weeks ago and I just couldn't. But Reverend Alex and Mama Gigori, I want to say a very big thank you for coming on the show. I tried that we should do it again last week, but it was beyond me. I was traveling again the following day and things were not okay, but at least the repeat wasn't bad. So Mama Gigoria and Reverend Alex, thank you so much. Anytime I have the opportunity to come to the UK, you are certainly coming on the show again.
All right, Mommy.
Charlie, I miss you. I miss
you too much. The next time I'm in your bag,
you have to be in my bag.
Well, Mommy, I was at the Emerge event with the teams, and it was interesting.
Oh, you were there.
Yes. One question that I heard one of the teens ask, which blew me, was the question, what is the global standard of banking and working? I'm like, you are in Ghana.
They're looking at global
standards.
Teenagers are so intelligent. Trust me, I won't be asking this question when I was a teenager.
Oh, not at all. Oh, we are thinking about the next meal. People were asking questions about integrity. Like, I'm going to write BC, whilst you are thinking about integrity. Deep things, and I think we would want to say thank you to the leadership for the great work they are doing. Over the weekend, I was at Sunyane University of Energy and Natural Resources, Rosa. Thank you so much, Pastor Stanley Doe and team. You are doing a marvelous work. I definitely will be coming back. Please get ready for 2023 Encounter with the Oil. Apostle General and Mama Rita will be stepping foot there. And it's going to be amazing.
Were you there?
Yes, Mommy, I was there.
Please.
Yes.
Tell them about the men's conference.
So when it started, I think the praise and worship was something else. I was blown away with the praise and
worship. All men in worship.
And then the first speaker, Reverend Derek, you know, his exposition was just something else.
Wow.
And then we spoke about something that usually we don't like to talk about, which is the will.
The will.
And once you talk about preparation of will, everybody's thinking, hey,
of death.
Am I? Yes. And you realize how important it is and what it comes with. Then you came and you took us to a different level. I was just blown away. And I really wish it was a camp and not, you know, a conference where we had it just for one day.
That's right.
It was a camp and we were doing it for 3 days, then we could have received more of you and more of all the speakers. It was just something else.
Wow. If you were not there, you were a man in Royal House Chapel and you were not there, you missed a lot. I mean, it was powerful. And I believe that every man who was there at that conference at least heard something, learned something, and their lives will be better. I want to say a very big thank you to Reverend Agri, Reverend Kim Foley, Apostle General, oh my God, for organizing this men's conference. The men are on another level. And I think that next year, I don't know, but next year, it has to be a camp, because what I saw this year, the whole room was full, packed full, and we had overflow.
Yeah.
We invited the women didn't come, just a few. But I realized that it was good they didn't come, because we wouldn't have had a place for them.
The place was full.
The place was charming, packed. Please, we will come your way again next year with men's conference. Men on mission. Oh, wow.
Well, we have some messages coming in already. Mm. We'll go to the backlog, but let's take this one. It says, good evening, Mama Rita.
Mm.
God richly bless you.
Amen.
Every episode of your program is always a blessing.
Wow.
This is Beatrice from Takrade.
Wow.
And then we also have John Biligomni watching from Wampuli in the Saboba district.
Wow.
Says, Mama Rita, you look cute as usual.
Thank you, my
God,
darling.
God bless you. Well, there's somebody who has just responded to our engagement on education and says, hi, Mama Rita.
Mm.
Thank you so much for such an insightful program.
Mm.
Please, I would like to ask, though it's not directly related to the education you've spoken about, it is in line with education. Says, what is your take on education as a priority in choosing a partner? As in a case where the woman is far more educated than the man is. Please advise me.
Since you are a man, let's start with you.
Okay.
If the lady is far more educated, and I like the word far more educated than the man, what happens?
Okay. Mm. So there are certain considerations that, you know, we usually talk about during the counseling stage.
Mm.
And the focus is to ensure that communication, which we always say is like oxygen to the marriage, is not taken away.
Mm.
So where education, the gap in education doesn't become a barrier to prevent effective communication from taking place. So usually we will advise that if the education has to be more, then it shouldn't be wide apart to prevent meaningful conversation.
Like
so
that.
While someone is talking about cryptocurrency and the rest, then someone has no idea,
you
cannot, because we want to have meaningful conversation. When I bring up a subject, you should be able to contribute, so the gap shouldn't be too wide. However, if we have a situation where the gap is wide, then the other person must ensure that they do whatever to bridge the gap so that communication can be effective. The other issue that has to be considered is if the education being in favor of the woman will not cause her not to be submissive. Because when that also rests its head, then that becomes a problem. So I have my master's, and then that's the woman. And then the man is just an SS lever. But the woman is still able to recognize her as the head, regardless of the education. Then you can manage. Mm. But where it is going to be a problem, then you need to be mindful. Mm. Don't say that, oh, once we get married, we'll solve it. Mm. What if the man doesn't want to continue?
Yeah.
And then that becomes a problem. Mm. So it is a subject that must be discussed during the courtship stage. Don't take it for granted.
Yeah.
Discuss, and you have to have plans on how to bridge the gap. And you, the woman, must also ensure that under no circumstance will you throw it in the man's face in any discussion. that you are, you know, maybe a PhD and the person
and
is
then
not.
Under no circumstances should a man also use it against the woman, even when it doesn't call for it. Because you have
exactly
because you have masters,
you think you are more educated.
Because you think you are more educated.
Not wisdom.
You know, education is not wisdom. I don't respect your education. Education, my food.
So rough, sometimes you are still under me.
You are still under me. You know, so sometimes the men also feel very intimidated by the educational standard and the educational level of the woman, and they rub it in their face. So I think that it must be really balanced. Mama responds.
Then again, if you are the woman and you are so high up there, will you feel comfortable taking a man like that to meet your friends and your colleagues? If you are called to a program, for example, you have to, there's a presidential program that you need to attend. Can you go with your husband? Will he fit in? Will he be comfortable? Those are, you don't just have to look at it with the feeling of, oh, I love the person. You have to use your head as well. And be very realistic. Most of the time when you're in love, you don't tend to look at the realities on the ground. It is only when you say, I do, and it's just left to the two of you before you start asking yourself, what did I do? But in cases like this, please ask yourself, what am I doing before you go and say, I do? Because the problems are wide. Just as the educational gap is wide, the problems will be wide. Are you ready? Can you stand it? Ask yourself those questions before you take a decision.
That's so good. So, my darling, you are listening to us. I always say that love with your heart and also love with your mind, with your brain. I see a lot of young women fall in love with anointing. They see pastors on stage. They see so-called men of God, prophets, prophesying, and they fall in love with their gifts. They don't fall in love with a person, but they fall in love with their gifts. Only to marry, get home, and notice that it's not a gift you marry. You get into the marriage and the person is missing L and R, missing the tenses, and you realize that you made a mistake. So please, I know a lot of people who have committed that mistake, and today they have regretted and they are paying dearly because they fell in love with the gift and not the person. When you are falling in love, let it be a very well-balanced kind of falling in love. You love the way the person leads worship. You love the way the person prays. You love the way the person preaches. When the person is prophesying and saying your mother is a witch, and you love it. But remember that will not be the only thing that you see 24/7 in the marriage. Number two, you fall in love with a person. You fall in love not with a person, but with a person's money.
Motive.
You are a graduate. The person is a JHS person, but the person has worked so hard and can put food on the table. The person has his own business, and because of it, you must always ask yourself, if tomorrow the money is not there, would you still fall in love with the person? If the money is not there, would you submit to the person? If his business collapses, would you submit to the person? So you must look at all these things and then make a very, very informed decision. And yes, I have PhD. The man is SHS. Is it okay? Like Reverend, like Minister Fabio is saying, would you be able to communicate effectively with a person? Like Mama Rosebud is saying, you have a high profile event. Everybody is going with a spouse. Would you be comfortable? Would you be proud of your wife? Would you be proud of your husband? If she has to join in the communication, I've gone to programs, and such women especially don't know how to keep quiet.
They it's want true. To have their say.
They want to have their say. I will keep quiet and not advertise
your
my
ignorance.
They will want to talk. Such men will want to talk.
They want to prove.
They want to prove that to this something. Is my wife. This is my wife. I came with my wife. I must say something.
Say something.
They
say
open
something.
Their mouth and, oh,
the walls of Jericho will come down.
So please, we are talking education, but these are things we must also look at. It's very, very important.
Mommy, you said something which took my mind to the movie night we had.
Yeah.
You know, the movie that we did, the Fireproof. You know, the man was excellent in his office. He was a good leader. He could put his life on.
Yeah.
But it was so horrible when it came to marriage. So let's not look at how successful someone is in one aspect and then quickly jump and then say, we want to go to the altar.
That's right.
And you may do that and then you come home and realize that you've made a mistake. So you've nailed it right on the head.
We will move to our next question.
Interestingly, the next question is related to what Mommy said.
Mm.
When the money is finished, would you still be in love with this man?
Mm.
So we picked a question that relates to this. It says, can the counseling team help me, please?
Mm.
I am married for 10 years. Ever since my finances went down, my wife has gathered boldness to tell me she does not love me anymore. It has gone so deep down, I always feel hurt and angry about this. We are in our own house that I built, but deep within me, Mommy, it is always anger when I see her face. We are all teachers. Please advise me.
Mama Roosevelt. There was love when the money was there.
So just like you said, the love was not to the man.
Yeah.
The love was to the money.
Yeah.
So if the money is no longer there, why am I here?
Yeah.
That is why when you want to marry somebody, there is something called courtship.
Mm.
The period of courtship is not for you to have sex. It's not for you to be fondling and kissing each other. It's for you to study each other. Study each other and make sure that this is actually what I want. The person loves me for me and not for what I have.
Yeah.
And then during courtship is not the time that you be buying gifts and trying to make sure and impress the person. If you impress the person and the person falls in love with you because of that, the day you can't impress the person, the person will leave you.
Yeah.
Or the person will show you gross disrespect because you are not able to do what you have to do. So in this instance, straight away you can tell that the person fell in love with his money and not him. So if the money is not there, then she doesn't really want you again. Is it a mistake that you marry the person? It means that you didn't see, you didn't look out for the red flags. You just went ahead and married the person. Being angry with the person will not solve the problem. What you can do is try and work yourself back in place. Whatever you were doing, work has gone down. Find something to do. Do your part as the husband. What do you need to do? You need to take care of the home. Make sure you are doing your part as a husband. At the end of the day, you are not the one who judge her actions or her inactions. You are not the one who will pay her for what she's doing. It is God. God is the judge of everybody. It is not in your place to be angry and be disrespectful or whatever, but it is your place to remain the husband. Remain a husband. And then God in his own way will bring and put her back in line. I believe so strongly that if you learn to trust in God and do your part, God also does his part.
But Mama Rosemont, before we come to Minister Fabio, we've said it severally here on the show. Yes, when you married, you had the money. You were taking care of her, taking care of the home. Now you don't have it. Maybe you've lost your job or something. What are you doing in place of the money? You see, this is what the men don't seem to realize.
Very true.
If you don't have the money, but now you have taken the responsibility of keeping the house, of tidying the house, of being the one to handle the kitchen, and the woman comes from work, and at least the home is tidy, the children's homework has been supervised, there's a meal on the table, I don't think that the woman will fall out of love with you.
That's true.
Mommy, you've taken that was exactly what I was going to talk about. So, aside the fact that when we start the marriage, usually the man is bringing something to the table that is providing and taking care of. Then the woman is also doing her part. Sometimes she also brings keeps the home. So if the balance now tilts to one side, and then she is still doing that and still has to provide, then it has shifted a lot of burden to her.
Yeah.
So the least thing, it will get her to, you know, say some of these things, which she may not actually mean, but because of some of the things that is happening. So like you said, apart from bringing, you know, the money, now that is not coming, what else can you do to also balance or tilt the scale back to, even if it's not 50-50, at least now you're bringing some 40% and then she's doing, I think with that help, so like you're saying, maybe you are not good with maybe preparing the meals, but like you're saying, taking care of the children, their homework, making sure if they have to be picked up, if it is, you know, doing the laundry, that does not, will not change your name or will not take anything away from you.
Your status as a man.
Exactly. That would see you as, you know, even providing some support. That can also be used as the time to bond with the children, spending some time with them while she is doing the other round. So maybe you need to look at it. It's not entirely because you are not bringing in the money that is causing her to change. We may be wrong because we don't have the full details. But at least as a first step, look at how you can also up your game on something else that the family needs so that you can support. Then you would see whether, despite everything you're doing, she's still saying that. Then you, because if you've lived 10 years, you've built a home together, I don't think, you know, just one day out of the blue, she will just get up and say she doesn't love.
When Apostle General came from Holland and we started church, certainly, you know, when you start church, the few years of church, you can't receive salary and blah blah, you know, and your money goes into it instead of they paying you. So it was like, it was just my salary that was running the home, paying school fees, utility, food, everything. But there was something Apostle General used to do. Anytime I woke up to prepare the children for school, he would say, leave that job for me. Just concentrate on yourself and go to work. So all I did at that period was to wake up in the morning, have my bath, dress up, and go to work.
Wow.
And he will prepare the children for school. He will prepare breakfast. He will bathe them, make sure that their books are in their school bag, everything. Drop them in school. Come back home and prepare lunch. On his way to pick them up from school, we'll stop by my office. Everybody knew Apostle General. I mean, everybody knew him. He would stop by my office and bring me lunch, put it in a basket, cover it with napkin, and bring it to me in my office. I mean, anytime my colleague saw him, there'll be a clap in the office.
Wow.
Pick the children from school, take them home, give them lunch, supervise their homework. I mean, by the time I got home, he would have bathed them, done everything. Why would I? I must be a witch.
Exactly. Yeah. Exactly.
I must be a witch not to appreciate a man like that.
Yeah.
So I never complained about me being the only person bringing income home.
Right.
I even became a fool because I get my pay slip and I take everything to him. Yeah. Decide what we must do, you know, with my salary. And I believe that it never changed him as a husband.
Right.
I respected him the more, fell in love with him the more. So if you are doing all this and the woman is not appreciating it, then the woman has something under her eyes. Trust me, then the woman has something under their eyes. But then if you are not doing this, and the woman is getting too stressed, we're going to work, providing, bringing her income home, and still have to do the one to take care of the house and the family, then I think that is a bit too stressful for her.
So mommy, I'm sure there's a possibility of a woman also listening whose husband is not bringing much, not doing the things we've spoken about, and she's supporting the home. We've had a couple of questions like that.
Yeah.
How should such a woman go about a situation such as this?
So we've said it's been answered here. If you're a woman and you are the one bringing the income, my darling, do it with all your heart. Remember that the man's situation might not always be the same.
That's right.
If you don't treat him well, now that the tables have turned, tomorrow when he turns back and he's the one bringing income, he's the one bringing more, you'll be in trouble. I remember when we married, my husband was a civil servant and I was working in the bank. So certainly my salary was about 7, 8, or 10 times more than his salary. But I never complained. I never nagged. I never disrespected him. Somewhere along the line, he got a better job. And his salary was more than mine because I had treated him well.
Right.
When his salary was more, he treated me well. So please treat your husband well. Don't nag, don't complain, do it with all your heart. But what we plead with the men is that be like my husband, be like the Apostle General. While the woman is the one bringing income home, you to do something. Take care of the home. Even if you don't know how to cook, let her teach you. While she's at work, tell her, I want to prepare contomre stew. What do I do first?
You can even cut the vegetables.
Blend the veggies, blend the tomatoes, blend the pepper, cut the... By the time she comes home, if these things are already done, trust me, she would even give you a kiss.
And more.
Before she starts preparing the meal.
It's a tried and tested formula.
So maybe you came from a home where you were never taught how to cook. It's okay. But cut the meals. Wash the veggies. By the time she comes, you know, if something is done, oh, trust me, she would never, ever complain. But I'm also pleading with the women. If you are the one bringing income home, it is okay. Do it wholeheartedly. Do it and still respect the man. Give him his due. Submit to him. All the hands are not equal.
All the hands are not equal. This is what Family Life Series is about. Building stable and happy homes. Keep your questions and your comments coming through. +233 200 515253. We are live on Facebook, Sam Kratiankra, live on Facebook, Mama Rita K, live on YouTube, Powerlight TV, and of course, your favorite digital channel. All our brothers across the West African region, across East Africa, Europe, America, wherever you are, please, let's keep talking. Use the hashtag AskMamaRita, AskMamaRita. We'll go to the
we
next one.
We can do one question and yes, then go on
yes,
the break.
Yes. Elmat P, thank you very much. You heard on the news, Rich James of Chelsea has renewed his contract for 5 years. nice outfit. I'm reminding you, contract renewal.
He has also renewed his contract.
God bless you.
I like that.
Well, Bobby, this is a rather long one, but we'll take it. Says, please help me. I met this lady on Facebook. That one is another topic altogether. And we fell in love with each other and started dating. And we've been dating for the past 2 years. She was once married and had a boy from that marriage. She had a second marriage after that and had 2 children from that. 3 children in all. She's 5 years older than I am. I am 32 years old, she's 37. I have never married, and my problem, everyone around me is telling me this is not a good step to take. She visited all the way from Bolga to where I am in the Volta region and stayed with me for some time. During this period, I was having my national service until later I got posted as a teacher. The concerns kept going higher from people around us. These are the concerns, mommy. Number one, he's listed them. I am very short in stature. Number two, she's weightier and taller than I am. She's actually about 3 times my size. Booziggy. Number three. As I mentioned, okay, the third one, he's mentioned already, she's 5 years older. She's married before with 3 kids. And she's currently not actively engaged in any work. Mommy, I am in love, but should I listen to the people around me?
Who, Minister?
Yes, so I'll look at it from just the dating point and what you are looking out for. So and my understanding of the relationship cycle is, you know, you start off as an acquaintance, then you become friends. Then once you think, you know, you want to get to know the person better, you know, then you go into dating. So dating is a period where 2 people get to know each other, trying to find out whether there are things that they see in the person that they like and want to advance the relationship into marriage. So it's a period where we study each other. If I find what I want, I need to make a decision. If I'm having issues, I still have to make a decision. So it's a very temporal situation. So now you are dating, but you are listing all these things, meaning that they are, you know, a source of worry for you, because if they are saying it and it doesn't bother you, I don't think you would, you know, consider it too much. So now that you're seeing it as a source of worry, now my question is, she has 3 kids already. Does she intend to have more? You don't have any child already. Are you thinking of, if she doesn't want to have any more kids, are you fine with that? Is that something that you've discussed? You are looking at the fact that, you know, she's 5 years older. Usually, these things should not become a problem if it will not bring communication issues and it will not lead to the woman feeling older and so would hinder her submission to you and respect. But if all these things are coming up now, then I think you should consider what the people are saying, because if it's not a bother to you and you are sure that these are things you can handle, you know, in the relationship, when you get into marriage, then you can consider that. But if it's a bother to you, the relationship stage, you have every liberty and right to walk off. It's better to have a broken relationship than to go into marriage and then now you go into a divorce. So you've listed all these issues, and I think that you need to really have a discussion with your partner and then you move on. One thing you said is she came to visit you from Bulga. So I hope you guys are not involved sexually for, you know, an unwanted pregnancy to come, and then that will force you to now stay with her. In the courtship or in the dating stage, we always advise that there are certain things that you must not do. So I'm hoping that when she came, she was in a hotel or in a different, you know, and then you were also somewhere else.
Well, because there are followers here. He says, whenever she visits, at least she spends a month. And these are his words. We have been having a lot of sex. We are using contraceptives.
Okay. So with this, then it's going to cloud your...
I wish you were.
it's going to cloud your judgment as to what to do, because you are engaging in things that during the dating stage you shouldn't. So that is why you are finding it difficult to make a decision. So I think that don't let the sex catch you like a glue and stick on and then lead you to do something you regret later. Look at the critical issues, advise yourself, and if you should ask me, I think that the issues that they are mentioning is much more than love. Amarita said, don't only love with your heart, but also use the mind.
Mommy, I don't know if you are going to want to respond, but there are other details that have come in. It says, she used to work at a filling station. My parents are also warning me about her, but she is begging me not to, because according to her, I've wasted 2 years of her life and she's madly in love with me.
Hey.
Before you talked about the fact that she's visiting and a month and they've been having a lot of sex, I was going to ask, what exactly is he in love with? What exactly is he look, because they met on Facebook. What did you see? What did you experience before you fell in love with her? And now I even get to know that you're having a lot of... So ask yourself, what am I in love with? Are you in love with the fact that she has two men already? And so she knows how to handle a man? Or you're in love with the fact that she's very good in bed? Or you're in love with the fact that she has children and probably you have decided you don't want children? So somebody who has children already is okay with me. What exactly are you in love with? Or she has a good character, you think she can help you build a home? What exactly are you in love with?
So, my darling, yes, people are discouraging you. But I always believe that, yes, at the end of the day, you are the one going to stay in marriage with a woman. And we keep saying, don't only love with your heart, love with your mind. 10 years from now, 15 years from now, you need to ask yourself, will her height bother you? Will her size bother you? Always, when you are falling in love, also think about the future. If in 10, 15 years' time, her size will not bother you, her height will not bother you, her age will not bother you, the fact that she has two children, is it two or three?
Three
children will not bother you. Go in for it. Number two, have you studied her very well? Does she have what it takes to be your wife? Does she have the character? Is she respectful? Is she submissive? Is she ready to also work to support you, take care of her three children? If you have weighed all these things and you think that you don't care about all these things, why not? You can marry her. But then, like Minister is saying, if the things people are saying is bothering you, her age, her height, her size, is bothering you, then it's better to break courtship than to go ahead and marry her. And then you get married and you have problems. So it will be very difficult to sit here to say, go in or don't go in. But we have given you all the clues. Are there red flags? If there are red flags, halt. Have a second look. Take a decision. But then, if aside all the things people are talking about, you think she's very good, she can be a very good wife, she has all the qualities of a very good wife, she's well behaved, then why not? Go ahead and marry her. I know people who have fallen in love with people, they married, and the men have or had low sperm counts and never had children. So from where I sit and the kind of issues I handle currently, if somebody has born one, born two, in other words, already has children and getting married, now trust me, if you ask me, I would say go into it. But what is everybody seeing that you are not seeing? What are your parents seeing that you are not seeing? Maybe you are only in love with the sex and that is all. Tomorrow, if you get married and you can't have sex anymore, ask yourself, will the love still be there? Would you still want to be married to her without sex? If the love can still be there, then go ahead. I don't know what church you belong to, but I think both of you would also need some counseling. So aside the size, the height, and the age, and then when it comes to the age, does she also look much older than you? If she does, then remember, in 10 years, in 20 years, it will look like you are walking with your auntie or your older sister. But if in spite of her age, she still looks young and she knows how to take very good care of herself, then why not? You can go ahead. If there's any other follow-up question, you can bring it to us and we'll answer you.
Well, I think we'll go on a short break. We should be back on your screens shortly. Thank you for sticking with us. This is Family Life Series with Mama Rita.
Royal House Chapel presents the Coming Glory Convention 2022. It is the gathering of all believers to receive an impartation to do exploits and walk in glory. Speakers, Apostle General Sam Kwanchi Ankra, Bishop Dominic Alote. Also featuring Emoji Music, Pastor Pa Chiamanti, Pastor Kofar. Date, Wednesday 28th September to Sunday 2nd October. And the time is 6 p.m. each night. Venue, the Oil Dome or Bechabi Lamte Interchange. The services will be live on Facebook at Sam Kwanchi Ankra, on YouTube at Powerline TV, and on your favorite Christian television channel, Powerline TV. It's the Coming Glory Convention 2022. Don't miss out. Miracles happen. Doors open. Mountains move. Walls fall. The dead rise. Impossible is nothing. Royal House Chapel, Possibility Center, Zenu presents Possibility Conference. Theme, I Believe. Mark 9:24. Date from the 4th to 11th September 2022, and the time is 6 p.m. each night, Sunday morning at 7:30 a.m., and worship and thanksgiving on the 11th of September at 6 p.m. Speakers, Reverend Daniel Darte, Pastor Frederick Chumesi Ankra, Mama Marian Agbeke, and your host, Reverend Kalistos K. Agbeke. Ministering the Voices of Possibility, Minister David Blessing and Reverend Perry Loco. Possibility Conference 2022, I believe.
Jeanette Services presents the 2022 edition of Women in Worship, themed The Holy Spirit Experience. Come Sunday, September 25th, all roads lead to Royal House Chapel International, Kanishi Roundabout, for a Holy Spirit encounter. Gates open at 4 p.m. sharp to lead us to the throne room of worship. All the way from Jamaica, Chevelle Franklin. From Nigeria, Judy K. From Congo, Deborah Lucali. And from Ghana, PSA Esther, Jude Lomote, and Celestine Doncor. Tickets are selling at 70 Ghana CDs single, 120 double, and 150 VIP. Visit Airport Shell, Bachina Total, Community 11, 1 and 2 Shell, Royal House Chapel, or log on to www.egotickets.com or dial *737*606# or download MyGH Pay. Sign up, select Pay Merchants, and search for Women in Worship. For ticket reservation, kindly call 024-88-10396. This event is brought to you by Official Media Partners, supported by. For further information, call 055-7747-977. Women in Worship. Daughter, you still have a voice. That's why we say, oh, say it.
Welcome back. This is Family Life Series with Mama Rita, Ask Mama Rita session. Across all media platforms, just use the hashtag ASKMAMARITA and you'll be part of the conversation. Your questions and your comments are all going to be read. Mama Rita and her seasoned counselors are here to address all your concerns. So we go to the next one, Mama Rita. Well, it's a compliment says, God bless you, Mommy, for this program. Well, he follows up with a question.
Yes.
I want to marry. God has blessed me with a virtuous lady, but I don't have money to marry her. Please, is there a way you can...
is there a way I can
you
help?
You can help me.
So, I do understand. Help you with money. Or advice. Help you with what?
Advice.
I think we need... I don't know.
So if it doesn't go about,
well, I think we've been able to handle such situations where we advise couples not to be very extravagant when it comes to the ceremony itself.
Yeah.
It's the journey that is important. Yeah. The ceremony is just to announce that we are starting the journey.
Yeah.
So if you don't have money, I mean. Important thing is for the two of you to agree and then you speak to the lady will speak to her family to understand that this is the gentleman, and then you know with the list they can be very, you know, what's the word, not so elaborate, but the main thing you know that needs to be done. When God blesses you along the line, like Apostle General did, you can always go back to honor the lady, you know, before her family. So you look at the most important thing. You're talking about the ring. You're talking about, you know, the traditional stuff that you need to do. You don't have to have, you know, a big reception. It's the reception and the venue and the food and that takes a lot of the money. But you can do a very small, you know, wedding, and at the end of the day, you start your life. So don't let money become a hindrance. Once the two of you have agreed, you love each other, you're claiming she's a virtuous woman. I hope she's also seeing you as a good man.
Yeah.
And then you guys can
is
can
there
start
anything up. Like virtuous man? Yeah. Why isn't there?
You're looking at her as a virtuous woman, but you should also look at yourself whether you also be, you know,
an integral.
Yes. Man. Yeah. Yeah. That. Thank you for the word. Yeah. To be able to provide a good, you know, relationship.
I mean, there's a couple in this church that I respect so much. I think now they've been married for over 10 years. We canceled them about 10 years ago. There was no money. Wow. So their reception, you know what they did?
No.
Water and fruits.
Water and
fruits.
Fruits?
Yes. They had a small two-tier cake. And it was a cocktail, so the fruit was set up in a small place. And bottle water. Everybody take water. Go and get your food. Here in Ainfi at the Glory Shed.
Wow.
Today they are blessed with children.
Look at that.
They are over 10 years in marriage, I think about 10 years ago. Yeah. And they are doing so well. If they looked at the money at that time, I don't think they would have gotten married.
Yeah.
But they wanted to do the right thing.
Yeah.
Bring the Mary before God and take the right steps. And they did just that with a little money.
Yeah.
And today, their story is different. So it's not about the money.
Right.
It's about the two of you agreeing on what you want to do and doing what you are capable of doing. Don't look at somebody's and plan how to do yours.
Yeah.
You end up in debt and the marriage will suffer because there'll be so much debt and there'll be so much unhappiness. Cut your coat according to your size.
My darling, cut your coat. I hope you understand that English. Cut your coat according to your size. Don't go and wear day. Don't make sure you eat or talk. So what they did is, they did or talk in Ayuwa. Mm-hmm. Ayuwa is a clay pot.
Earthenware.
So they did it. Did it like a pyramid and then put eggs around it.
Wow, that would be nice.
It was so beautiful. And they cut it. After the cutting, everybody had like a spoonful or two spoonfuls of the otor with a piece of the egg. And that was the reception. We went to church on Sunday. After Sunday, we went home. The groom, the bride, the maid of honor, myself, the best man, and a few friends went home. Ate kenke and sardine. Oh my God. And the fun.
Yeah.
My darling, you don't need money to get wedded. If you are in a church like Royal House Chapel and you are very committed, in Royal House Chapel and your wedding is even announced, 20 CDs, 50 CDs, 100 CDs, 200 CDs, you'll be shocked.
Yeah. Shoe.
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 Yeah.
Shirt.
Gown.
Cake.
Someone will take
so it. If you don't have the money, other people had weddings before you did. You can get somebody's gown. After the wedding, nobody uses it. You can get the person's gown and wear. You don't need reception to go and pay 70 Ghana cedis. 850, is it 70?
7,000?
No, 70,000 for their call.
70.
Yeah.
You don't need it, my darling.
Do they go home with the decor material?
Don't need it. Somebody's coming to have a wedding and I'm cutting the cake. So I asked, are you having your reception? You know, she said, mommy, we are not doing reception. I said, why? She said, because of the decor. I clapped for her. So they are doing packed meal.
Exactly.
So right after the wedding, I cut the cake. They share the packed meal and everybody goes home. My darling, you can go to Mokola. For those of you who do not know Mokola, I don't know how to describe Mokola. Mokola is an open market. where we sell everything. You can get very cheap rings. You don't need gold. The sister of gold, what's the name? The one that is sold at Mokola.
Abyssinia.
No, not Abyssinia. The one that...
Cooper.
My darling, when you go to Mokola, you get Cooper rings. And when you look at them, they look like real gold. The only thing is that when you are bathing, you remove them because this is real gold and diamond.
To Cooper fire.
I can bath with it. I never remove it. But my darling, I got this when I was, is it 25 years in marriage or 30 yeah. years 30, in marriage?
30. This was 30 years.
30 years in marriage. This is what I got. My first, my wedding. It was my mother's ring, engagement ring, that they gave to us to go and melt. Even that, I think they added a lot of copper to it. So when I use it, within two weeks, the thing is white. That is what I used until my fifth anniversary, I think so. So fifth anniversary, we got, it wasn't even gold. We got something that could...
With a little carat inside.
With a little...
Carat. Mm-hmm.
That could take us for another 5 years. So I wore gold rings for the first time when I was 10 years in marriage.
Wow.
That is when we had three sets, two rings, and then two wedding rings, and then one engagement ring. So those ones carried me for another 15 years. By the 30th year, the Lord has blessed us. My darling, you won't continue not to have money.
No.
The Lord will bless you. Amen. As long as there's unity and there's agreement in your marriage, and you are able to put your resources together, you can do a lot of things. At the time our daughter was even going to nursery, we didn't have what it takes. We took her to nursery around our neighborhood. When the Lord started blessing us, and I started working in the bank, we took her to learning skills, an upper grade. We saved. Took her to Morningstar. My darling, it doesn't come within a day. Don't do what somebody else is doing. And I always say that in some families, Auntie A will say, I'm buying drinks. Auntie B will say, I'm doing the pastries. Uncle A will say, I will give the car that you'll be sitting in. Uncle C. Some people furnish your home for you. So when you see these big weddings, my darling, if you are a first generational person in your family,
you are your own uncle.
your own auntie. your own grandmother. You are the one who has to sew clothes for your mother and your father.
That's true.
Your mother, your father-in-law to be, don't be like everybody else. Go for somebody's ring. We have people here that can take you to bend down. You get nice suits, and people will think that you bought it in Harrods or Macy's in America. Wear it. Come and serve water and fruit. Go and start your life. There's no point in borrowing money. Going to rent a hall. Where you, somebody came to Reverend Agri, give me 10,000 to go and rent a hall. I said, Reverend Agri, you should have told the person you're a big fool. Meanwhile, they didn't even know where they were going to stay after the wedding.
Wow. Imagine. I think you understand why people...
And this is the trend now, is to rent halls. When we have a big space here,
for free.
I went to somebody's place, wedding reception. There was no parking. The place they had rented was so congested. When this place is lying here free, the only thing is that when you have your reception here, you can't serve alcohol. You can't go and serve, play worldly music. That is all. But we have a big place here as a royal that you can come and use as a your reception.
So you don't charge for electricity, nothing.
Nothing. Oh, we don't charge for electricity. We don't charge water. We don't charge your guests for using our toilets. You don't pay for instrumentalists.
Orchards, free.
You don't pay for technical people. You don't pay for ushers. I mean, everything is free.
You know, in some churches, they pay for these.
They pay for these things. In Royal House Chapel, everything is free. You don't pay for the pastors coming to bless your wedding. The only thing is that your fifth anniversary, when God has blessed you, remember all the people who did the free of charge for you and say, oh, ushers, at the time I was having my wedding, I didn't have it. Now God has blessed me. Take 200, buy some minerals, serve your guests. Hey, serve yourselves. The pastor who blessed you, your 10th anniversary. Oh, Reverend Kim Foley, at the time I had my wedding, I didn't have it. Today, God has blessed me. We are celebrating 10 years. This is 500 for you. Your counselors, at the time you had your wedding, all the 10 weeks or how many weeks of counseling was free. Sometimes you did the counseling in their home. They served you water. They served you drink free of charge. Even some of our counselors help. They pay some of the items. Yeah. They help. So tomorrow when God blesses you, don't turn your back at them. Come and also, well, I would say come and bless them, but be grateful for what they did for you. So my darling, you don't have money to marry the lady can. If the lady is the one working and can bring you her cloth, 6 pieces of cloth, can write a check and say, this is your dowry. First check, it is okay. But tomorrow when God blesses you, remember the woman who was there for you, that brought her jewelry and said, use it. Brought her cloth, 7 pieces of cloth and said, use it. Did what? Brought her shoes, her underwear, everything to make the thing beautiful. Yeah. Even brought you her suitcase. Please, tomorrow, and I always say it here, I've said this so many times, I can never stop sharing this testimony. During my engagement, my husband was still in school. He wasn't done with the University of Ghana. He went to my father and said, give me the list. My father said, I know you are still in school. Just provide whatever you want to do. He brought trunk. The trunk was sprayed nicely. Collected cloth from his sisters. Filled in. Somebody gave him, he didn't even have a bank account. Somebody gave him check. Wrote big money, dowry. Came to present it. We did engagement on Saturday. On Monday, I had to return the trunk. I had to return the 6 pieces of cloth. Return the jewelry. The check, I had to return it. Everything.
The only thing that wasn't returned was yourself.
The only thing that wasn't returned was myself. But this is a man who was going somewhere. Mm. When we got married, 3 years after the marriage, said, get ready, we are going to see your parents. At the time, I didn't even know what it was. Got home, only to realize that he was going to do a repeat of the engagement. My darling, why won't I bow when this man says I should bow? Why won't I jump when he says I should jump? We got the cloth that was collected from me. Those cloth was GTP and the other one.
ATL.
That was the cloth I returned. When he was coming back to part two, he brought me Holland.
Wow. Right.
The trunk that was returned, suitcase. He brought me suitcase. And the suitcase was, I think, a set of four. That was put in the in one suitcase.
Yeah.
Brought my parents and the money for mother-in-law, money for father-in-law. The dowry that he didn't give to me, he gave to me 3 years after the wedding, after the engagement, brought everything to me. My darling, women are not stupid and foolish. Yes, during the engagement, you didn't have it. I said you could bring everything. But now I see the money is coming. Mm-hmm. You've changed your wardrobe. Mm-hmm. You've changed your shirt. You've changed your shoes. Now I see the watch you are wearing. Now that God has blessed you and you have a good job, at least return the kindness and return the respect.
Wow. Wow. A lot of teaching. You can only get this on Family Life Series, where you get practical lessons for life issues. Well, we'll move on to the next
one. Don't get money today and now know that your wife is not dress well. Your wife doesn't dress well because of you. Mm. My darling, if you see people who dress well, look at them well. Find out where they sold their things. Mm. Take your wife there for her measurement to be taken.
Yeah.
And that is one thing my husband did for me.
It's true.
When we started being blessed, he took me to the tailor, bought fabrics, and said, these are the styles I want. Wow. My darling, your wife will bow. Mm.
Yeah.
Now that God has blessed you, you have a laptop, you have
an iPhone.
iPad.
95-inch TV.
Are you watching heaven?
Yeah, watching with heaven.
Heaven. Well, take God bless you, mommy. Great education, enlightenment from this program. You are amazing.
Thank you.
Priscilla from Brekum also says, good evening, mommy, and your panel.
Good
I just
evening.
Love this program.
Wow.
God bless you. I wish to see you one day.
You will see me. Anytime you come, especially over the weekend, you can make your way to Royal House Chapel, Ahimfie, and then say you are looking for Mama Rita. You don't need to book an appointment to see me. I see anybody, whether tall, fat, short, 5 years older than me, everybody I see. All of them, so you can always make your way to Ahimfie and I'll see you.
And to authenticate, CC of Sunyani, God richly bless you.
Mm.
She's one of our very loyal listeners.
Wow.
During the WMG camp, she got her daughter, Victoria, to join the team from Sunyani to Accra just to come and see Mama Rita.
Not a member of Royal
Not a member.
Family.
That's
wow.
the first time her daughter comes
wow.
to see. And it was amazing. Mommy blessed and prayed for her. Chess. And you can also do same.
Yeah.
You have no idea what that encounter will do for you, your family, your children.
Yes.
God richly bless you.
I remember the lady who also came from, is it Kumasi or Sunyani? I think Kumasi came all the way to University of Ghana.
That's true.
When they were having
what? Jesus Saves Crusade.
Jesus Saves Crusade.
Yeah.
Just came to say thank you.
Oh, wow.
She said, I have saved her marriage. Today she's outside the country for her master's.
Yeah. Oh,
came, I mean, drove all the way. She didn't know me. Does it? She's in, she's in Canada now.
Oh, wow.
She's in Canada now. And to say thank you for repairing her marriage. So, my darling, when we have programs like Week of the Altar and 21 Days of Fasting in Royal House Chapel, when we have our conventions, when we have our Royal Ladies Camp meetings, we have our Men's Camp meetings, we have our WMG, that's the Youth Camp meeting. You can just come, you know, come and introduce yourself to me and say, I've been listening to you on Family Life and you have been such a blessing. Wow.
We are going straight to the Bono East region of Ghana, Yeji. He gives his name, he says, good evening. I am a young man who has a strong desire and interest to do the work of God. I found this lady with whom I share a common interest, and we've been planning for marriage. Mommy, she is unable to read or write. For 3 years, I've tried assisting her to learn to read, gotten her support from other people to assist her as well. Her character is solid and great. I've tried to be happy with her situation, but mommy, it is just not working anymore. I love her, I know. I want this to change. I am afraid if I marry her, I may not have the kind of joy in marriage that I anticipate. She won't be happy either. What should I do?
Minister, I think you have answered.
Let's address it again.
I think recently I have learned something when it comes to dealing with people who don't want to make changes to things that they're doing. And one of the learned is using the benefit and consequence model. So sometimes people need to
benefit
know
and consequence model. Yeah.
So people need to know, if I do this, what is the benefit?
Okay.
And if I do this, what is the consequence? If I do not change this, what is the benefit? If I do not change that, what is the consequence? And sometimes when people understand the benefit and the consequence of certain actions and inactions, it gets them to think and then, you know. So if this is something that is bothering you and can lead to you changing your mind on the next step you're going to take, I think you should have that conversation with her, that this is the consequence of your inaction, you know, because yes, you have solid character and everything, but where I am going, I will need you to be able to, this is not, I need you to go to university or do your master's, to be able to read and write. So let's start from that level. And I think the gentleman is being, you know, honest with himself. He's realized that this one, if you don't have it, it will be difficult for us to continue with this relationship. So let her know that, you know, this is the consequence. Because I think he has made an assessment and come to the conclusion that without this, it will be, you know, impossible for the relationship, you know, to go on. And then again, maybe you can get somebody that, you know, she has some reverence and respect, and let the person also add, you know, their voice, you know, to it, and see if that will get her to change, you know, her mind, to at least start the process of learning how to read and then how to write, and then we can take it from there.
Before we come to one thing I've been teaching the young people now, look at where you are going and choose a partner. Will this person, lady, gentleman, will he be able to go with me to where I am going? So I've discovered that a lot of people look at themselves today.
To choose.
Today, I am just SHS products. So they are looking at their kind or looking at somebody much lower than them. But then tomorrow, are you going to remain SHS? I know people who attended teacher training, went for people their kind, not necessarily teacher training, but went for people below them. Because if I'm teacher training, let me go for JHS. Only to realize that they entered into the university, did the first degree, a second degree. Some of them even entered into politics, only to realize that there was no balance. Just like we are saying, I started going for high-profile meetings, high-profile functions. I needed to go with a spouse. I needed to go with my wife. I needed to go with my husband and realize that they didn't fit in. So my darling, yes, she has the character. But when you look at her level today, will she be able to take you and carry you to the next level of your life? I don't know your academic standing now, but even if you are SHS, You might want to enter into the Bible college.
Yeah.
After the Bible college, when things are okay, now God starts blessing you. You might want to go and do a first degree. You might want to go and do a second degree. If tomorrow you belong to a church like Royal House Chapel, where you are made a resident pastor, do you think that a woman who doesn't read or write fit in? And this is where now people are thinking about either divorce, or I won't divorce you, now let me go for a girlfriend, let me go for a second wife. So I'm glad you are not married. And this is why we always say that don't be physical with a person. Don't start going to bed with a person. Once you start going to bed with a person, I mean, you are locked forever. You don't have the moral ability to go to hell. I want us to break up. Your conscience will not even serve you well. She's a good girl, but remember that she will get a level who will love her for who she is. Unless that you can be patient enough for her to be able to go to school, and we are looking at the foundation, very, very foundation, where now she's learning nursery things. She's learning our birthday. She's learning 1 + 1 = 2. She's learning that So would you be patient enough? If you think you can't be patient, it is very good to break the relationship now. If it's difficult to break the relationship, meet her before an elderly person, before her pastor, and then let her understand, you know, the dynamics of what you are going through. Mama Rosebond,
if for 3 years you have, and you are talking about it now because it's disturbing you, why would you want to take the next step and go into marriage with this level of disturbance? You just get the marriage before it starts.
Unless
if he's talking about it,
do you mind?
And
10 years from now, 15 years from now, 20 years from now, 30 years from now.
And if you want ministry, like you want to be a pastor, you are going to preach somewhere and say your wife should bring greetings. Why is she coming? You feel very.
To limit the level because your partner is not giving you that support. So you should really consider what we are saying.
Interesting. Our time is running so fast.
Oh my God.
We'll probably take one or two more questions. But keep your questions coming. We definitely are going to make time to address all of them. Mama Rita will make sure that is done. This one says, good evening, Mama Rita.
So please let your questions continue coming.
Yep.
Like I promise you all the time, we will find time and answer all your questions. Correct. If you in previous times, in previous episodes, and we haven't answered, don't worry, we will certainly and answer all the questions. So let your questions continue coming.
All right, our next question. Good evening, Mama Rita.
Good evening.
And greetings to your panel.
Good evening.
Mama Rita, I am, she gives her name, from the Volta region, 32 years. Please, I have been dating this gentleman for the past 9 years.
32.
You are building the Tower of Babel. She continues, whenever I raise the topic of marriage, he gets angry. And this is really disturbing me. Mama Rita, please, I need your help. What should I do about this?
Mama Rosemont.
Feels like a trap.
That guy is not ready to marry. He's not ready for 9 years.
9 years, and you are 32.
And you are 32.
It means you started at what age?
23.
23.
Yeah, 23.
And I'm sure now she's feeling like she's wasted enough time. Yeah. And
it's better, each year. It's better to waste and wasting.
Yes.
And find somebody who is ready to marry, then continue. And he might not even marry you in the end.
Yeah.
So
you people like that, sleeping together.
Yes.
Because what will keep a man from going out with you 9 years and not marry you when you are 32? You are not a child. You are not in school. Mm-hmm. It's not like your school fees is being paid. Not my Rosemary.
My darling, so is there's too much red flags. Red flag in the sense that he will not take you to the altar. Mm. If you want to marry, unless you don't want to marry, but if you want to marry, end this relationship now. Because, and it's not like he's giving you an excuse. He gets angry.
Yeah.
When you marry, then he doesn't want it. If you want it, there are people out there who want marriage. Out there who will be. End the relationship, my dear. End the relationship and then find somebody else.
And don't ever tell yourself you are too old, you've wasted time, nobody will love you. In your current state, there's somebody out there who is you like an egg. Please run for your dear life now. And if the guy is serious, my darling, if you break the relationship, he will come chasing after you. Hide it. When the men who chased this lady have been missing heaven. They came chasing after them and, you know, married them. So try it and stop with him. If he loves you, he will come back chasing for you and fix the marriage date. If you stop with him and he doesn't come back, my darling, he's not worth a pinch of salt.
There's something, a theme that keeps coming up in this. So during the courtship, there are certain things that you must not do. Because then once you are offering everything before,
you are cooking for him. For him, tidying up his house. Somebody called me, Mama Rita. And he was sick, and I went to take care of him, and I was preparing light soup, and I was tidying up. Odudo is herbal, you know, for him. And I said, you have been foolish. I'll tell you the way the Bible says. Sent you to go to him and tidy up his room for him, to go and boil water for him to have his bath. My darling, I don't.
There's no need to go, you know. And are trying to find other. If I don't find what I'm looking for, I should be able to say, let me look for it somewhere else. So bad about it. I think the time we feel if I break off, break the relationship, everybody would say that I am the one who caused
it. It's better to break it than to go into marriage and have headaches. And not be happy. Crying is one thing I have learned. When there are red flags, put a break.
Right. Yeah, so I think it's been said. 9 years, you are bringing the subject up, please.
Please, this my one. Darling. I pretended I didn't know how to do anything. I go visit him. I'll cross my legs. He will go to the night market, buy eggs, come and fry, buy bread, cut it. I will send you, prepare me tea. I will go to him in Lagos and be washing for him. Yeah. How are you going to wash? Are you going to change your dress and wear his T-shirt and wash?
I hear some are even cleaning louver blades and window nets.
What? Mm. My darling, he won't be in a hurry. My husband finished school in June. We got, he did the engagement the February before June. He was so much in a hurry. See, I give him everything. Why would he be in a hurry to marry you?
It's been amazing. 25 years, and I'm dating a 20-year-old man. Ah, he's 25, and the way I date old man, no, I'll continue. He has 2 children with 2 different women. And he divorced the second one after they had initially married. He moved his mother, his sister, his brother, and the children, and 2 other extended family members into his current home. When he proposed marriage, I asked him if he was going to get another place for us to stay so we can start our marriage together quietly. But he said no. I should move in until he's finished his other building, and then we can have our privacy. Mommy, I am not in favor of this, but he also insists because he has done knocking, I should park into his house. What do I do?
I don't know when knocking became
knocking is not.
I think a lot of people call
knocking is
not
marriage.
Knocking is introduction to the parents.
Exactly.
To your parents.
Is that introducing
or announcing your intent?
Yes. So it's not even engagement. Yeah. Knocking. And he's moving. And he's married 2 people, 2 women already, and divorced them. Bringing you in at the age of 5, knocking and coming. The math doesn't add up. It's, besides, the house is already filled with mother, siblings.
Father, siblings, uncle, auntie, and grandmother.
You, 25-year-old, you should come and say, he has how many children?
Two
children, so that you come and mother the children for
you. You are going to be a housemaid in the house.
Thank you very much. My dear, you yourself are saying that it doesn't order well with you. Mm. You see it as a red flag. Mm. Then don't. Because I believe that before you go into marriage, you should have the peace.
Yeah.
Peace of mind and the peace in your heart that you are doing the right thing. Now, from what you are telling us, it looks like yourself, you don't have the peace. So step back. Step back from the relationship and see if he really, like Mommy said, if he really loves you, he will do exactly what you are saying. But then again, I'm looking at the age gap, Mommy. 40 years and 25, that's about 15 years different. Look at the future. By the time he will be 60, how old are you? At a point, you'll be taking care of an old man. Look at the future. Mommy said, look at where you are going and see if this person can take you there. At the age of 25, what is your dream? Where are you going? Where do you want to go? Are you sure that this man will be able to take you there? And then I'll ask the question again. Why do you want to marry this man? Is it because he's meeting your economic needs?
Yeah.
Or why do you want to marry? Ask the question, what exactly does he do for you? And for that reason, you think he's the best husband for you. I believe that if you ask yourself those questions and seriously pray about it, God will give you the path that you should go on.
I would want to find out. So your parents, your people, what are they saying? What advice are they giving you? Because you can see signs of someone who is economically supporting either the girl or her family.
Yeah.
Because, you know, to order you to move in.
Yeah.
I mean, if you are in a family where your parents are taking care of you and nobody can come to them and say, move in when the person hasn't
done the
completed
right.
The right thing. So you are right in feeling that this is a wrong move. So please, there are so many issues here. Apart from the age gap, there's also you being a 25-year-old going to now manage all these people, because the man is the one taking care of them. So you are going to mother all these people in the house. When are you going to enjoy your marriage? When are you going to build your marriage? When you are taking, it's like you are being taken to the house to go and serve these people rather than to go and marry. So please advise yourself, and then, you know.
So my darling, your question has been answered. It's not in your interest to do that. Number one, knocking is normal. Knocking is announcement of intention. Knocking can easily be broken. What is legally married is the traditional marriage. And then the type 3 marriage, that is the one we say wedding. Within the context of Ghana, the traditional marriage is recognized as marriage. Except that for us as a church, we always think that you must move a step higher and bring God in. But for our legal, you know, sense, you are married when traditionally you get married. So he has no right to ask you to move in when he hasn't finished the marriage rites. Number two, here is a man who has 2 children, taking care of a mother, a father, sisters, brothers. I'm sure more will come and add to it. He's the one that takes care of the whole family. When you move in, do you think you can mother a husband, mother a father, a father-in-law, mother a mother-in-law, mother siblings-in-law, and then the mother 2 stepchildren? If you think you have what it takes, then fine. The house that must be completed before you move in, trust me, is going to take another 25 years. So we think that we have given you all the clues to take an informed decision. 25, you are still very young.
Too young.
If you leave this man, somebody else will come your way. If he's not ready to do the legal thing by doing the traditional marriage and then moving you to a place where at least you can start life with him and the 2 children he has, then please advise yourself. Don't let what he's doing for you, maybe he paid your school fees, maybe he rented a place for your parents. Don't look at these things and then take a decision. Look at your happiness tomorrow and look at where you are going tomorrow. I think on that note,
we will
call it a night.
Mommy, if you don't mind, just before we put the curtains down, I would want to remind everyone, 3 weeks exactly from today, the Apostle General is gathering the whole nation. It is Convention 2022. The coming glory, happening at the Oyo Dome. The Apostle General himself is going to be around, and Bishop Dominic Alote from the United States is also going to be around. I know you don't want to miss this because it's going to be heaven here on earth. Thank you, Mommy.
And then right here, I am moving to Obuasi, where Apostle General is having a program, a crusade with the churches in Obuasi. My relatives in Akokeri, please find your way to Obuasi. The program starts actually, but I'm moving right from there And tomorrow morning, that is Thursday morning, I'll be with them Thursday morning, Friday evening, I'll be with them. We are having a program in the evenings, and then in the morning, Apostle General is having pastors and pastors' wives and leaders of churches conference. Please make your way to Obuasi and be part of the services going on there. And trust me, your life will never be the same. We will call it a night. Have a good night. Next week now, as I sit down here, I'm actually very confused what I am going to do. What I wanted to do was I was going to do temperaments. Everywhere I go, people are telling me, Mama Rita, we want to know about temperaments, teach on temperaments, on family life. Now, our teens, you know, parents and leader are also telling us about choosing of subjects and schools, and but we will see what we can do. Before next week, Wednesday, we would have taken a decision. But as I sit then here now, I really want to do temperaments. Mm. But we will see. Maybe we might do the educational one before the temperament. Because temperament is going to take us another 1 month to 6 weeks. Mm. I'm not sure how fast I can go with temperament. So please keep your fingers crossed. Sit by your television, your iPad, your laptop, Instagram, Facebook, Powerline TV. And I think I like surprises.
Yeah.
We will see what next week, Wednesday, will bring. Have a good night. Take good care of yourself. Continue watching Family Life with Mama Rita. And let your marriage be beautiful. God bless you, and we love you.